I'd like, it's a pleasure for me to introduce Dr. Yana Koseka, who's a professor in the Department of Computer Science at George Mason University. She obtained her PhD in computer science from the University of Pennsylvania. And following that, she was a postdoctoral fellow at the in the Electrical Engineering and Computer Sciences Department at UC Berkeley. She is chair of the IEEE Technical Committee for Robotic Perception, associate editor of IEEE Robotics and Autonomy Letters, and on the editorial board of the International Journal of Computer Vision. She has held visiting positions at Stanford University, Google, and Nokia Research. Today, she will talk about visual representations for navigation and object discovery. Please give a warm welcome to Professor Koseka.
Let's try this. Okay. So I'm glad that we have no technical difficulties. So thank you very much for the invitation. It is my pleasure to speak here and also meet many of you in person, which I haven't seen for a few years. So it's sort of exciting that we can sort of start meeting again. So I'm going to talk a little bit about our work in the past several years in the space of robot perception, and particularly related to the strategies and mechanisms for acquiring visual representations by learning, which could then assist various navigation tasks and object discovery. So, when it comes to robot perception, I'm going to focus on strategies for acquiring some semantic information about the environment, with the idea that if we can endow our robots with some better understanding of the surrounding environment, we can, the robots then can accomplish more sophisticated tasks and will have sort of better functionality. So I'll focus on the perception side, on strategies, how to detect objects of interest, how to discover new objects, how to recover the pose of the existing objects, and also how to semantically segment the scenes, namely how to understand the part of the scenes which are not objects. And then I'll sort of shift the gears a little bit and start talking about some strategies how to tackle the navigation problem in previously unseen environments. So this is sort of a little bit of a departure from the traditional approaches how navigation was tackled in the robotic setting. And so we'll discuss what is the role of machine learning techniques in this stage, and how we can sort of advance this field. So a lot of our work is motivated by this idea of this fetch and delivery tasks, which the robots were to sort of carry out in household, manufacture, sort of warehouse, dynamically changing complex environment with a lot of clutter. And so here the motivating example is fetch me an object from the refrigerator. So in order for the robot to do this, we need to recognize first where the refrigerator is. One also needs to know what is the pose of the object, right? Because you need to understand where the handle is in order to open it. You also need to understand what are the obstacles and where the free space is in the environment, such that the safe path can be planned towards the goal. And so historically in robotics community, this was tackled by sort of separate approaches, and then these were sort of put together, and the interfaces between these individual building blocks were often brittle, and that sort of resulted in sort of brittle systems, which one was sort of able to demonstrate this type of tasks in individual environments, but it was very hard to achieve the robustness and generalizability. So the individual components in the traditional approaches were typically, you have one component where the model of the environment, both geometric and semantic, is built, usually by human guiding the robot through the environment and making sure that most of the parts are seen. And so this was the camera was in this case, or the range sensor was under human control. And then this model is then sort of passed along to somebody who works on motion planning and path planning, then the plan is path, the path is planned, and then this path is then sort of handed on to somebody who works on control, and then the path is followed. And so you can imagine that these interfaces between these blocks are often very brittle because a lot of things can change between the time the model was built. The model may not be perfectly accurate for the path planner to find the path, and so forth. So in computer vision, and also, I mean, these days in robotics, the field has really sort of greatly benefited from, especially on the robot perception side, by the use of various machine learning and data-driven techniques, which sort of dramatically improved at least the perceptual components of these tasks. And so we wanted to understand how some of these methodologies apply to these robotic problems, and also what are the challenges in applying these methodologies in the robotic setting. So in computer vision, which is, you know, some other activities which I'm engaged with, there has been a lot of work done in the semantic understanding of the environment. But the environments in the computer vision setting are usually comprised of internet images, where we have all of data has been collected by researchers gathering images from various photo sharing sites, labeling and understanding what are individual objects of interest, and then training models which could recognize and localize these objects of interest. And so the most commonly used object categories, they're comprised about sort of 80 to 100 categories as of say 3-4 years ago. And the performance of these techniques is about 80% accuracy on average on these types of data sets. So this is sort of encouraging. I think at least on the computer vision side, we sort of have better tools and techniques how to interpret images and the semantic content. And another thing which is encouraging is that these techniques are actually quite applicable to real world settings, right? Because we can make these models work in real time. So this is a model for object detection, which is trying to detect commonly encountered object categories like chairs, tables in indoor environments, which can work very fast in these sort of indoor settings. So this basically suggests that these techniques are also mature for robotic setting because both because of the real-time aspects and also sort of reasonable accuracy, at least for these commonly encountered categories. So what are the sort of the weaknesses or challenges in order to transition some of these ideas and technologies to settings which would be relevant for robotics applications? So the type of environments robots encounter are very different than the type of environments photographers capture while they're trying to share their photos on the internet. So the environments have a lot of statistics. They usually do not have this sort of nice photographic composition. If you can imagine, as the robot is moving around in the household environment, there is a lot of clutter, there are a lot of irrelevant viewpoints. And most importantly, there are a lot of objects which simply do not exist in these large data sets which people have created and which are of interest to a lot of this sort of photo sharing or I guess social media sites where people are sharing their photographs. So the first line of work which we did is we embarked on this strategy of trying to develop these object detection techniques for objects which would be of interest to look for and also which would be of interest to be manipulated by the mobile manipulators, right? So these are typically various instances of products, and the goal would be the robot would have to find the object. And then these are also the same type of objects which are being used in different manipulation benchmarks. So once the object could be localized and found, then the idea would be that the manipulator can then grasp it and, you know, deliver it to a desired location or somehow manipulate it. So once the approach how we, oh, sorry about that. This is about me. So we embarked on this problem of building these object detectors on this data set of these household objects. And these are the type of objects which actually have 3 detection models available. And so the big challenge for training these big neural network models is the availability of the training data. So we embarked on adopting the one of the most successful object detection frameworks, which first detects some object hypotheses and then tries to classify them and localize them. And we embarked on the strategy of actually generating the training data for this object detection framework. And the training data was generated synthetically by imposing, using the computer graphic techniques, this 3D textured model into the various places in the environments where they might, where they are likely encountered. And this enabled us to generate a very large training set without actually requiring any labeling. And so when we use this training set in order to train the model for detect the object, we, without any real data, we acquired about, we had about 60% accuracy in detecting these 15 object instances. And with increasing number of real data, which we acquired creating our own data sets of these various kitchens where these objects reside, our data set, our accuracy went all the way to 85%. So this was one strategy where the models of the objects you are trying to detect are available, both the 3D models and the texture mapped models. And you have some approach where you can post with some scene understanding of where the big planar surfaces are and what are the scales of the objects, you can correctly position these objects at different scales in the environment. So now what happens in scenarios where you do not have these type of models? And we were interested in the question of, can we just go around in the environment and learn what the objects are? And this led to this approach to so-called self-supervised object discovery. And in this line of work, we were sort of interested in this strategy, if we can gather the data for training the object detector by simply moving around in the environment and associating different hypotheses about the objects in the 3D space using the structure and motion cues, and then use so-called contrastive learning to train the model. So let me, before I proceed, let me first sort of introduce the environment, the data set which we used for this. So in order to do these experiments, we have created a data set of indoors environments, which we scanned about 15 houses very densely with 13 views about every 30 centimeters. So this is, you can think of it as this sampling of all possible viewpoints of this environment. So this enabled us to have actual real data, which was densely sampled. And then we could formulate both our detection problem, path planning problem in this sampled version of the real environment. But it also enabled us to have basically these repeatable experiments, because we could run sort of multiple trajectories and have some repeatability, so we can understand what are some of the challenges and difficulties. And so these environments, again, were populated by these objects of interest, which we were trying to detect. And so the idea of this self-supervised strategy was the following. This is an example of the data set. This was with our collaborators at University of North Carolina, and it's called Activision Dataset. So the idea of this self-supervised strategy was the following. So we are going to rely on the object hypotheses, which are already generated by the state-of-the-art object detection detectors, the so-called region proposals, which reasonably well overlap with majority of the object categories. But we would like to now understand what the individual instances in particular environments are. So because we are moving in the environment and we can perceive the 3D, we have this ability to associate these object proposals across multiple views. So here is an example of the object proposals which were successfully associated. So the bounding boxes. So in this first picture, you can see that you have a lot of different proposals where the objects might be. In the follow-up picture, we only have the ones which were successfully matched across the views. So now we can use this matching information as a training signal for, again, deep neural network. And I'm kind of assuming that I'm not doing an extensive introduction in this methodology, but you can imagine that this is sort of these are these established techniques where you take an image, you have several layers of convolutional neural network, which extracts some features and then generates predictions about, in the traditional object detection, about class predictions of the individual object proposals and then the bounding box coordinates. So we, instead of generating these predictions, we would take the last layer of the convolutional neural network where the region proposals are being generated and take the features associated with these region proposals. And we are going to formulate the so-called contrastive learning problem where the loss function for fine-tuning the network would be the one of trying to make the features of the proposals which matched to be close together versus the features of the proposals which were not matched correctly to be far apart. So here is, we would pick an object and we would find the corresponding object in the subsequent view. And then we would find another object which we would consider as a negative example. And then the loss function would try to bring the representations and the embedding of the matched object together while make the representations or embedding of the negative of the anchor object and the negative object far apart. So this methodology enables us to build representations where if we then go and finish this learning process, and do some simple clustering in this high dimensional embedding space, the clusters themselves correspond to the individual instances of these objects. So via this mechanism of being able to tell what is the same versus what is the difference, we can fine tune or learn better representation, which is adapted to the environment where the robot lives, does not require any supervision. And then we can use traditional unsupervised machine learning techniques, such as K-means clustering in order to discover what the objects are. And here are some examples of the things which we have learned. So here is a clustering result for the, I'm having actually difficulty seeing the bounding, but oh, for this is for the trash can. So this is, you can see this trash can in the back, which is something we, you know, was not part of the training set. Here is one for shower curtain, and there is one for some towel. Here are some additional clustering results for different objects sitting on the countertop. So these objects were simply discovered via this moving around and learning procedure. Of course, if we want to evaluate it, we then have to go and kind of compare different strategies. So there are different ways how to then tie it back to the standard evaluation pipeline. We can either say each cluster is one object and somebody names a representative or the name of that object, and then that's going to be the object instance you are trying to evaluate the accuracy on. Or alternatively, you can use the entire cluster as a training example for the traditional object detection. So this is roughly the performance of this type of approach on a subset of objects for which we had ground truth labels. And we achieved about 50% accuracy when we used the strategy of using the entire cluster as a training data for the object detector. And I just want to sort of show you that these environments are very challenging. The objects are often very difficult to see. They are very small. It's easy usually to confuse different type of instances of the object. So I'm actually showing some of the failure cases of both heavy occlusions, kind of confusions between some serial bars versus there is sort of another serial box and so forth. So this is, I think, I will talk in a little bit about some strategies, how to improve and tackle some of these failure cases and misclassifications. So I want to just highlight that in the robotic settings, these self-supervised strategies are very effective because robots can move and associate measurements in the environments as they move along using the traditional structure and motion recovery techniques, which are well developed. And so we are now in the process of extending these ideas to also the problem of semantic segmentation. So now, instead of just generating hypotheses of the bounding boxes, we would like to label every pixel in the image by some semantic category. And again, we would like to do it with a very little training data. And the training data can come either from another labeled data set, or it can come, it can be labeled by the users in that particular environment. So this is sort of ongoing work, which is in preparation, hopefully, for the next year. So let's pause a little bit and think about what are the limitations of these techniques. So one challenge is that the accuracy of this object detection dramatically depends on the viewpoint. So what we are seeing here is bird's eye view of different viewpoints where from our data set, and the color of the location is corresponding to the accuracy or the confidence of the prediction of the object detector. So you can see that as the viewpoint or the robot moves further away, the object becomes very small, the detector is very, the confidence decreases. But also in certain situations, you can be still quite close, but as you move and change the viewpoint, parts of the objects can get occluded, then you completely lose the accuracy in detecting the objects. So this then suggests that in the robotic setting, this problem should not really be tackled in a static setting, but we should actually try to learn how to recognize objects by endowing the robot with the ability to move. And I'm not going to have time to talk about it, but we have sort of developed some strategies how to actively recognize the objects of interest by training a policy in the reinforcement learning setting, where the agent basically learns how to move around while the reward is then being given. This is related to the accuracy of detecting particular objects. And again, this is something which we can do in our data set, because although it's just discretely sampled, we can sort of generate some discrete actions on the grid. So in the interest of time, I'm going to skip the part on pose estimation, but you can imagine that It's not enough just to detect where the object is. Object lived in 3D, and in many cases, it is of importance to also understand what is the pose of the object. This is a particularly useful in, so there are two variations of this pose estimation problem. One, you want to know pose because you want to grasp an object, and this is where the pose ties as an intermediate representation between the manipulation and perception, but also for semantic understanding and mapping, being able to recognize or detect certain objects and their pose, we can very effectively actually replace them by the 3D CAD model, if approximate CAD model exists, and then develop this very nice and accurate watertight model of the environment, where we don't have to deal with these challenges of sensors and sensing, which we need to always overcome when we are tackling these problems. So here we tackle this pose estimation problem by this problem of actually retrieving the CAD models, which look most alike to the objects which we are seeing in the environments. And then we could also, since we know the pose of the object, we could replace the object with the CAD model. All right, so I'm going to spend the last 10 minutes talking about navigation. And so this first line of work focused on attaining better spatial representations of the environments, which are endowed with semantics, both about the objects and non-object categories. And this is often the final goal. And so we would like to now go and see if instead of just spending all this effort building these models of the environment, whether we can also learn some navigation strategies using some representations. And this would then enable us to tackle the task of navigation, finding objects, or going to some point goals, also using these data-driven techniques. So before we embarked on this journey, there were basically two lines of work. One was the traditional, where you build a model, then plan a path, and then sort of navigate along the path. And then again, with the success of these data-driven machine learning techniques, there were several approaches which were trying to learn these navigation strategies directly from images. So this was sort of initially introduced in the context of autonomous driving. Like you can imagine that if you have a lot of examples of mappings between what the driver sees and the steering commands, you can sort of learn quite reliable policies in the environments where the training data comes from. So if we would like to, however, generalize to different type of environments of different appearance, trying to learn things directly from images is very challenging. So the first work which we embarked on is so trying to understand whether we can learn these navigation policies from the representations of the environments which we obtained using this semantic understanding. So object detector, semantic segmentation, and maybe the depth. Now, so the navigation problem here is a little bit different, and it is the so-called target-driven navigation problem, where the goal is not specified in terms of map coordinates, but it's specified as a target you are supposed to find. So the task is go and find a given target, and we would like to understand how to learn a mapping between some representation of the environment and the actions. And so here we have exploited the representations which we used for semantic segmentation and object detection, and again, learned the policy to map these to fuse these representations and map these representations to actions with some recurrent component modeled by the recurrent neural network with some memory. So as you can imagine, this requires a lot of training data to train policies and models like this. And in this setting, we use some combination of the data from our Activision data set and some simulated environments. And the appeal of the visual representations which we use was that because the representations were semantic, we didn't really have to deal with this simulation to real transfer, which often is challenging when you are trying to learn visually guided policies in simulated environments, because the simulated environments do not have really, you do not have the desired level of visual realism. There's always some gap. So let me kind of go faster through the results, and I'll be happy to discuss it during the break. But here are some examples of the policies which we have learned. So here the agent was initially in the kitchen, and the target was to find the couch. And after kind of wandering around a little bit in the kitchen area, it moved towards the corridor and saw the couch. So one intuition for what is really being learned here is the policies are trying to exploit some correlations between the semantic content in the environment in order to figure out how to guide the actions. So if in the training stage, the couches are usually in the living room, it's quite unlikely that it is going to be in the kitchen. So the agent then kind of moves away and heads towards the living room. Again, as I mentioned, that trying to, even though we are already using kind of more compact semantic representation, this is still very challenging. So later we actually embarked on, instead of learning the policies directly from the images, trying to learn the maps first, right? Because at the end, once we have a good map, then we can use the local path planning techniques in order to reach the goal. We don't have to be learning the policies between the observations and local actions. And so here are some examples of the map learning, where we know the geometry of the robot system. We can project the semantic information onto the ground and then learn the local map and also learn how to anticipate the map. So this was then later extended by my student, George Gergoriakis, where the kind of the reinforcement learning component in some sense was taken out, and then the focus was just on improving the map and using the local path planning techniques to guide the robot to the regions with high uncertainty. So, you know, going through sort of a lot of these examples of data-driven techniques and how they can improve both perception and different navigation strategies, we are currently kind of in some sense closing the loop and going back and trying to exploit more structured models, where we are trying to use these data-driven techniques to actually learn strong priors about the environment, which would then enable us to actually use this more traditional belief maintenance techniques, which are more interpretable. We can sort of properly estimate the uncertainties. And we are sort of applying these strategies to, again, this target-driven navigation and point goal navigation tasks. Because in some sense, while these techniques have been studied and well understood before, they have never really been exploited in the setting where we had so much data, right? So the priors which we were able to learn before were much weaker. And so we believe that kind of going back to these more structured methods, we can further, at least it's sort of as the initial experiments indicate, we can further improve the performance and robustness of these strategies. So that's all I have. Discuss the various architectures for integrating perception, planning, and control. I think self-supervision is a great topic to think about. I think in robotics, this idea of generalization to all possible environments, it's sort of less critical than being able to adapt your models to the environments where you operate. And so starting with some models and having some self-supervised techniques, which would enable robot better understand the environment where it operates, I think it's a very promising directions to go. And the other ideas is, you know, we are in this era where we have a lot of data, but we also have a lot of opportunities how to exploit this data towards sort of better models, better architectures, being able to quantify better the uncertainty and have strategies which allow you some introspection, what is really happening. I think this is quite critical for robotics application. And, you know, the data sets like the ones which we created and many more simulated data sets which are becoming very much commonplace in this line of work are really key to towards delivering these repeatable extensive experiments, which can then transfer to the real world. Okay. And I of course want to thank you, my students, collaborators, and the funding agencies. Thank you.
Okay. Semantics. Let me ask you something. You're so known for geometry. What do you think, how geometry plays here a role? Recognize objects by shape?
Yes, so I think the later work, which I did not talk about as much, so the post estimation work, it's very sort of geometry guided. So we are sort of exploring strategies how to do matching and also the post estimation where possibly the entire pipeline is differentiable. But so this is definitely the place where the geometry can be either on the outside of the loop where you just deliver good matches and correspondences and solve the post estimate optimization problem separately, or it can be also integrated with the entire pipeline. So we use a lot of geometry, it's sort of under the hood, but yes, so there are, you know, a lot of different lines of work where the geometry of course plays a lot of big role.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, one more question from the audience. Right, please.
In the self-supervised operator,
so the proposals in this case come from the pre-trained network, but the accuracy is affected by the weight of the pre-trained network. So if the statistics of your environment is significantly different, you are going to miss a lot of things which the pre-trained network never knew about. And I think so there is this role for the self-supervised component, even when it comes to fine-tuning or training from scratch the backbone network. But this was not what the experiments here reported. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you, Jana.
Thanks.